The roots of education are bitter, but the fruit is sweet. So with this quote, I will start today lecture. So already we know that we are discussing about the phase detectors. The phase detectors are mainly classified into two types. Those are analog phase detectors as well as the digital phase detectors. So in analog phase detectors, again we are having two types. Those are switch type and balanced modulator type. In digital phase detectors, we are also having two types. Those are exclusive OR gate and SR type. So today we are going to discuss about the digital phase detectors. So as we already know that the phase detectors are also called as the phase comparators. It will compare the input signal with the signal coming from the VCO. And according to that, it will generate the error waveform or error voltage, and that error voltage will be transferred to the low pass filter. The low pass filter will eliminate the high frequency signals, and that should be passed to the amplifier, and from the amplifier the signal will be coming to the input of the VCO, and according to that the VCO will changes the frequency, and that frequency will be again given to the input of the phase detector. So in this way the PLL works. So let us start our discussion with the digital phase detectors. So the digital phase detectors are classified into two types, XR digital phase detector and SR flip-flop type digital phase detector. So as we already know that exclusive OR gate, in exclusive OR gate the output of the output is high when only one of the input signal is high, otherwise the output will be low. So if the two inputs of the exclusive OR gate are high, are the two inputs of the exclusive OR gate is low, or the two inputs of the exclusive OR gate are equal, in that case the output will be low, otherwise the output will be high. So let us understand the operation with the help of waveforms. So here the exclusive OR gate is having the two inputs, those are FS and F0. So here FS is the signal coming from whatever the input signal we are giving, and F0 is the signal coming from the VCO, and so this is the FS signal. So I am taking some phase difference pi in between the FS and F0. So the exclusive OR gate output is high only when there is a difference between the FS and F0, otherwise the output will be low. So if you observe the waveforms from here to here, from here to here, the FS is high and F0 is low, that's why the output is high. So from here to here, here to here, here the FS is high and F0 is high, that's why the output is low. So here the exclusive OR gate identify the difference between the FS and F0. If there is any difference, in that case the output will be high, otherwise the output will be low. So let us try to draw the curve between the phase differences, the phase difference pi versus the DC output voltage, whatever the error voltage we are getting. So the maximum error voltage we are getting only when the phase difference between the FS and F0 will be pi, otherwise we are getting the error voltage will be zero. So here I am drawing the curve between the phase difference pi between FS and F0 to the DC output voltage what we are getting at the output. So we are getting the maximum output voltage only when the phase difference equal to pi, otherwise we are getting the error voltage will be zero. So here this is the phase difference versus the DC output voltage curve. So I am trying to calculate the slope. The slope is also called as the conversion gain K pi. The slope is represented with the conversion gain K pi. That is nothing but, so this is the, this line is represented with this one. So here this point is 0, 0, and this point is x axis I am having the pi and y axis I am having the VCC. So if you calculate the slope for this curve, that is nothing but VCC minus 0 by pi minus 0, that is VCC by pi. So if you take the VCC value is 5, in that case 5 by pi, the value is 1.59 volts per radian second. So this is about the digital phase detector, that is exclusive OR gate. Next type of digital phase detector is the SR type phase detector. So in SR type phase detector, just the circuit is an RS flip-flop made by using the NOR gates, such as the number is CD4001. The circuit is useful when the incoming signal and the incoming signal FS and the F0, that is the VCO output, are both pulse waveforms with duty cycle less than 50%. So what is duty cycle? Actually, the duty cycle is nothing but the on time by total time. Total time is nothing but on time plus off time. So when this duty cycle is less than 50%, in that case only these SR flip-flop is useful. SR flip-flop type phase detector is useful. So in order to understand the operation, so let me take the waveforms. So here I am taking some phase difference between the input FS and the VCO signal F0. So SR flip-flop truth table is Q, Q bar. So when S equal to R, R equal to, S equal to 0, R equal to 0, in that case the output is unchanged or previous state. When S equal to 0, R equal to 1, in that case the output is 0. When S equal to 1 and R equal to 0, in that case the output is 1. If both are 1, that is the invalid state. So with this one, we are trying to analyze the circuit. So here if the S is 1 and R is 0, in that case the output is 1. So in the second case, if the S is 0 and R is 1, in that case the output is 0. So in this way, the SR type phase detector will detect the error signal. S is 1, R is 0, in that case the output is 1. If S is 0, R is 1, in that case the output is 0. If in this way, the SR type phase detector will detect the signal. And if you are trying to draw the curve between the phase difference versus the output voltage, here you are getting the maximum error voltage when the phase difference is 2π. So in the previous case, you are getting the maximum error voltage when the phase difference is π. So the next part in the PLL is the VCO. So voltage controlled oscillator. The voltage controlled oscillator is generally available in the form of IC. So that IC is the 8-pin IC. The IC number is the 566. So the IC is the 8-pin IC. The 8 pins are, the first pin is the ground and the second pin is the no connection. Depending on the application, we may use the no connection pin. And the third pin is the square wave output and the fourth pin is the triangular wave output. Fifth pin is the modulation input and the sixth pin is the timing resistor. Seventh pin timing capacitor. Eighth pin VCC. So let us discuss one by one. So here, this is the block diagram of the VCO. Normally the oscillator is the circuit which will generate the waveform without giving any input. So similarly here, the voltage controlled oscillator is also circuit. Here it will generate the waveform and that waveform frequency is proportional to the voltage applied at the input. So that's why it is called to be voltage controlled frequency. So whatever the voltage you are applied here, depending on that voltage, the frequency of the output waveform changes. That's why it is also called as the voltage to frequency converter also. So here, mainly the block diagram consists of constant current source or constant current sink and the buffer and the Schmitt trigger and the inverter, and here we are having the some RA and RB resistors, timing capacitor, modulating input and the sixth pin, here the timing resistor. So this is the block diagram of the IC566, that is VCO. So in order to understand the operation, already we know that the output of the Schmitt trigger is square wave. So the output of the Schmitt trigger is square wave. I am assuming one condition, that is the maximum voltage here is some VCC. The output of the Schmitt trigger is square wave and that maximum voltage is VCC and the minimum voltage is some 0.5 VCC. This is the first condition I am assuming in order to understand the operation of the VCO. And the next condition is, I am assuming that RA equal to RP. RA equal to RP. The first condition is the output of the Schmitt trigger is the square wave, and for this square wave the maximum voltage is VCC and the minimum voltage is 0.5 VCC, and here RA RB values are equal. So let us say if the Schmitt trigger is having the maximum voltage, that is VCC. So if here I am having the maximum voltage VCC and I am saying that this RA and RB values are equal, that's the reason the VCC will be divided equally in between the RA and RB. So at this point the voltage will be 0.5 VCC because here RA equal to RB. So due to this VCC, this VCC is connected to the constant current source, and here some voltage through RT is connected to the constant current source, and here I am having the modulating input signal also. So due to this the capacitor will charges. So the capacitor charges, the charging capacitor voltage will be connected to the buffer circuit, and from buffer circuit it will be given to the inverting terminal of the Schmitt trigger circuit. So once here I am having the 0.5 VCC initially, and the capacitor starts charging, and that voltage should be transferred to the inverting terminal of the Schmitt trigger through buffer. So once the inverting terminal voltage or the capacitor charging voltage exceeds the 0.5 VCC, in that case the inverting terminal voltage becomes greater than the non-inverting terminal voltage, so the output becomes low. Initially it is high and it will become low, and this low voltage will be given to the inverter circuit. Due to the inverter circuit the output becomes high. So first I am assuming the output of the Schmitt trigger is VCC. So if here it is having VCC, in the sense the voltage divided equally in between RA and RB, that's why here the voltage is 0.5 VCC, and this VCC is connected to the constant current source or current sink, and here VCC through RT it is connected to the constant current source, and by the modulating input signal we are applying some voltage. So due to this voltage the capacitor starts charging. So whenever the capacitor starts charging, that voltage should be transferred through buffer to the inverting terminal of the Schmitt trigger. So after some time the inverting terminal voltage exceeds 0.5 VCC or it is equal to the 0.5 VCC. In that case the inverting terminal voltage is greater than the non-inverting terminal voltage, so the output of the Schmitt trigger is low, and this will be given to the inverter circuit. That's why the output is high. And in the second case, if I am saying that here the voltage is some 0.5 VCC and here the voltage is some 0.25 VCC, because here the voltage is divided equally because RA equal to RB, and due to this 0.5 VCC here this voltage is very less, and the capacitor starts discharging, in the sense that voltage should be transferred to the A1, and here also I am getting the lesser voltage than the 0.525 VCC. So whenever the non-inverting terminal voltage is greater than the inverting terminal voltage, then the output of the Schmitt trigger is high, and this high signal is transmitted to the inverter circuit. That's why the output becomes low. So in this way, depending on the voltage applied at the modulating input and the voltage coming from the Schmitt trigger, the output frequency of this waveform will be changes. And here the capacitor will be charged, and that will be given, the charging voltage will be given to the buffer circuit. So the capacitor charging will be represented with the increasing curve, and whenever here we are having the 0.25 volts or some lesser voltage here, 0.5 volt VCC, so in that case the capacitor starts discharging, and that voltage should be transmitted to the buffer, and the discharging path is given by the decreasing capacitor, decreasing path. So this is the triangular waveform and this is the square waveform. This indicates the fourth pin, and this is the square wave output. This is the third pin, and here CT, this is the timing capacitor and timing resistor, VCC and the modulating input by changing the modulating input signal or by changing their timing resistor value or by changing the timing capacitor value, we can control the output voltage or output frequency of this waveform. So now let us try to derive the equation, the output frequency equation. So as we already know that the capacitor current equation is I equal to C dV by dt. So I by C, I am representing C with the CT. I by CT equal to dV by dt. In place of dV by dt, I am writing variation in voltage with respect to the variation in current, that is del V by del t. So already we know that the capacitor voltage changes from 0.5 VCC to, it will charge up to 0.5 VCC and it will discharge up to 0.25 VCC. So the difference between these two is 0.5 VCC minus 0.25 VCC is the 0.25 VCC. So the capacitor charges up to the maximum value 0.5 VCC. The capacitor discharges up to the maximum value 0.25 VCC. So the difference between these is 0.5 minus 0.25, that is equal to the 0.25 VCC. So in order to derive the equation for the output voltage, I am taking the capacitor equation, that is I equal to C dV by dt, and I am representing C with the CT, I by CT equal to delta V by delta t. So the total voltage on the capacitor charges from 0.25 VCC to 0.5 VCC. The difference between those two voltages is the 0.25 VCC. So in place of del V, I am substituting the 0.25 VCC. So in place of del V, I am substituting the 0.25 VCC and by del T equal to I by CT. So delta of T equal to 0.25 VCC into CT by I. But here we need to calculate the I value. So from the circuit diagram, the I is nothing but current flowing from here to here. This is the I value. So I is nothing but VCC minus, so here the modulating input voltage will be VCC minus VC by RT. That is the I value, VCC minus VC by RT. So I am substituting the I value here. The I value is nothing but, VCC minus VC by RT. And as we already know that frequency is nothing but, the frequency is nothing but 1 by t. So here already we are having del of t. So f equal to 1 by t. But here I am considering only 0.25 VCC to 0.5 VCC. That is only del of t. But in order to consider the total time period, I have to take this waveform and this waveform also. That is nothing but del of t plus del of t. So the total time period equal to the 2 del of t. So the frequency is nothing but the reciprocal of the time period. So frequency equal to 1 by 2 del of t. So here the equation becomes, already we know that del of t is equal to, 0.25 VCC CT by I. So 0.25 VCC CT by I and I equal to VCC minus VC by RT. So I am substituting these equations here. So finally I am getting VF0 equal to VCC minus VC by 0.5 RT VCC CT. So 1 by 0.5 is the 2 VCC minus VC by RT CT. So here again the circuit operation. So whenever the voltage at the pin number 4 increases from 0 to some 0.25 to some 0.5, so in that case the Schmitt trigger output goes high and the output at pin 3 goes low, because here we are using the inverter circuit. And whenever the voltage decreases from 0.5 to 0.25 VCC, in that case the output of the Schmitt trigger goes low and at the pin number 3 we are having the inverter, that's why the output is high. So here The output frequency is depending on the RT value, CT value, and the voltage applied at the modulating input terminal. So let us say at pin number 5, we are having the voltage of 7.7/8 VCC. So I am assuming this VC equal to the 7/8 VCC. So I am substituting VC value 7/8 VCC in this equation. So the equation becomes 2 VCC minus 7/8 VCC by CT RT VCC. So this is nothing but 1/4 RT CT. That is equal to 1/4 is nothing but 0.25 RT CT. So the final frequency is 0.25 RT CT. So here we are going to calculate one more factor, that is voltage to frequency conversion factor. So in order to calculate that one, the voltage to frequency conversion factor is nothing but the ratio of change in frequency with respect to the change in voltage. The ratio of change in frequency with respect to the change in voltage. The ratio of change in frequency with respect to the voltage. So already we know that the frequency is nothing but the 2 VCC minus VC by CT RT VCC. The frequency is nothing but 2 VCC minus VC by RT VCC into CT. And we need to calculate the change in frequency with respect to the change in voltage. So in order to calculate that one, first I am taking the change in frequency, that is nothing but some F1 minus F0. So in place of F0, directly I am considering the 2 VCC minus VC by CT RT. And in place of F1, I am adding some more voltage in addition to this one. In place of VC, I am adding VC plus del V, del VC, VC plus delta VC, because I am adding some another controlled voltage at the modulating input. So here we need to calculate the change in frequency with respect to the change in voltage. So already we know that F equal to 2 VCC minus VC by CT RT VCC. And that is nothing but the F0 value. So in order to get some F1 value, I am adding one more voltage, that is del VC, in addition to this one. So I am taking the difference between these two terms. So that is nothing but 2 VCC minus VC minus del VC by CTRT VCC minus 2 VCC minus V plus V 2 VC by CTRT VCC. So that is equal to 2 del of VC by CTRT and VCC. So here del of VC equal to del of VC equal to, I am multiplying CTRT VCC term with the del of F0. So del of VC equal to del of F0 CTRT VCC by 2. So already we know that CTRT value is from the previous slide. So CTRT value 0.25 by RTCT equal to F0. So from this, RTCT value is nothing but 0.25 by F0. So I am substituting that value in place of RTCT. I am substituting 0.25 by F0 VCC. So from this I am getting del VC equal to del of F0 VCC by 8 F0, because 0.25 equal to 1/8. So finally the voltage to frequency conversion factor is nothing but variation of frequency with respect to the variation of voltage equal to 8 F0 by VCC. So the another block in the PLL is the low pass filter. As we already know that the low pass filter is used to block the high frequencies, and it will allow the low frequencies. We can construct the low pass filter by using the passive components such as R and C elements, and we can construct the low pass filter by using the active components like operational amplifiers. So the low pass filter not only removes the high frequency components and noise, but also controls the dynamic characteristics of the PLL. The characteristics are nothing but capture range, lock range, bandwidth, and transient response. So in this lecture we are discussing about the digital phase detectors. Those are XR gate and SR flip flop. After that we are discussing about the VCO. So it is the 8-pin IC. The 8 pins are ground, no connection, square wave output and triangular wave output, and modulation input RT, CT, and VC. So after that we are studying the operation of the block diagram. So in order to understand that, we are taking the first condition, that is the output of the Schmitt trigger high is square wave, and the high value is the VCC and the low value is the 0.5 VCC. If the higher value is VCC, in that case here the voltage is 0.5 VCC. If the output of the Schmitt trigger is 0.5 VCC, in that case the non-inverting terminal voltage is 0.25 VCC. If the output of the Schmitt trigger is high, then the capacitor starts charging. Capacitor starts charging in the sense that voltage should be transferred to the inverting terminal of the Schmitt trigger. So once the inverting terminal voltage is greater than the non-inverting terminal voltage, in that case the output will becomes the high, and that high voltage will be, sorry, the output will become low. So that low voltage will be transferred to the output of the inverter, input of the inverter. We are getting the output is high. So after that we are studying about the frequency equation. So in order to calculate the frequency of the VCO, output frequency of the VCO, we are taking the capacitor current equation. So that is nothing but I equal to C dV by dt. So from this equation we are deriving the frequency. So for that one we are taking the total voltage of the capacitor. The total voltage of the capacitor varies from 0.5 VCC to 0.25 VCC. The difference between the 0.5 VCC and 0.25 VCC is the 0.5 minus 0.25 is the 0.25. This is the only one cycle. So in order to calculate the frequency, we have to take the total time period, that is nothing but 1 del of t plus 1 more del of t, that is 2 del of t. So f equal to 1 by 2 del of t. After that we are substituting the del of t value. So finally we are calculating the frequency, that is equal to 2 VCC minus VC by RT VCC and CT. So after that we are the output frequency can be changed either by changing the timing resistor and timing capacitor and the voltage at the modulating input terminal. And we are assuming that the voltage at the modulating input terminal is some 7 by 8 VCC. And after substituting that one, we are calculating the F0 value. The F0 value is 0.25 by RTCT. And after that, we are calculating the voltage to frequency conversion factor. The voltage to frequency conversion factor is nothing but the ratio of change in frequency with respect to the change in voltage. So in order to calculate the change in frequency, I am taking the two frequencies, that is F1 minus F0. Here the F0 is the frequency we are calculated initially, that is 2 VCC minus VC by CT, RT and VCC. So here F1 is nothing but we are adding one more modulating input signal voltage, that is del VC to this, that is 2 VCC minus VC plus del VC by CT RT into VCC. So I am taking the difference between these two. So the final value is 2 del VC by CT RT into VC. So del of VC equal to del of F0 CT RT VC by 2. So already we know that from the previous slide, CT RT equal to 0.25 by F0. So I am substituting that value here. So finally I am getting the voltage to frequency conversion factor is 8 F0 by VCC. And the next block in the PLL is the low pass filter, which is used to attenuate the high frequency signals. So thank you all.